Welcome, everybody. We're ready today for study 3 in 1 Timothy. Let's get started. We're going to break it up today into two different sections. First of all, we want to look at 1 Timothy chapter number 3, verses 1 through 7. And the question we're going to attempt to answer is the following. In those first 7 verses, what are the qualities required in those who exercise leadership in the church? And know what Paul says about their personal character, their Christian experience, their general reputation, and their abilities, and why does he put so much stress on the personal life of a Christian leader. So let's look at 1 Timothy chapter number 3 and the first 7 verses and see what those verses have to say. Here is a trustworthy saying. If anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. Now the overseer must be above reproach, the husband of but one wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money, and he must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him with proper respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. And he must also have a good reputation with outsiders so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. So let's look at that question again in light of those first 7 verses that we just read. What are the qualities required in those who exercise leadership in the church? And note what Paul says about them. Personal character, the Christian experience, and their general reputation and abilities. And why does Paul put such stress on the personal life of a Christian leader? Well, it would seem that a leader, according to Paul, must be above reproach in a variety of different areas. In regards to self-control, he can't be subject to being drunk, or mishandling his finances, or losing his temper, or being subject to violence. And his family must also be a model of what it should be like, what a Christian home should actually look like and how it should be acted out in public as well as in private. And as to his abilities, he needs to be able to teach other people. He also needs to be someone that is regarded as important in the community, and how he hospitable person is also important as well. And Paul encourages Timothy not to choose leadership among those that are recently converted because they aren't quite ready maybe to be thrust into the spotlight, and they could easily lapse into moments of arrogance. And finally, it was deemed very important to be respected in the broader community outside of the church. And he also places a great deal of stress on the personal life of a Christian leader, because one's personal life is the well, so to speak, from which we can draw and be able to bless others. If we don't have anything there, if we are lacking in that, then we are not going to have anything to offer other people. Going on to the next section of this scripture, 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 8 through 13, the question that we are going to answer is, what are the qualities that are necessary for deacons? Now, this isn't the leadership of the church, but these are deacons in the church. We'll make that distinction in a moment, or deaconesses. And compare your answer to the question in question number 1, and note how largely the element of self-discipline enters into these qualifications. And in light of this passage, how do I measure up to the standards that God requires? Or in your case, how do you measure up? So let's read these 6 verses here in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 8 through 13. Deacons, likewise, are to be men worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, and not pursuing dishonest gain. And they must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience, and they must first be tested, and then, if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. In the same way, their wives would be women worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything. And a deacon must be the husband of but one wife and must manage his children and his household well. And those who have served well gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. Now let's look at the question that we're being asked over those passages of Scripture in 1 Timothy 3, 8-15. What qualities are necessary for deacons and deaconesses? And compare your answer to that in question 1. And note how largely the element of self-discipline enters into these qualifications. In light of this passage, how do I or you measure up to the standard that God requires? Well, first of all, the guidelines for a deacon and deaconess are nearly identical in this passage of Scripture with the first 7 verses concerning leadership in the church. And it should be noted here that the word deacon means servant. We tend to misuse this word and position in churches today. Normally, when we refer to the term deacon, we're actually referring to a church leadership position. But it would seem that in the churches that Paul was helping Timothy to establish, this term was referring to those that would be the official servants in the church, not necessarily leaders in the church. In our setting, this would apply more to servant roles within the church. People are going to help clean the church, mow the lawn in the church, do any variety of different things within the church, but not necessarily a teaching ministry, which is what Paul would say is a leadership ministry within the church. Paul tells Timothy that even those that are in servant roles within the church need to keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. In other words, those serving in the church need to be able to explain the doctrinal positions of the church, have an understanding of why they believe them to be true. This is something that would have automatically been assumed of those in leadership being talked about in the first 7 verses, so it wasn't necessary to talk about that or to mention that in that previous.